Before I get going, there's one thing that I think I need to clear up, and that's not associated with how we think particle physicists look. I'm not from round here. This is typically the first thing people notice when they meet me, so I thought I should address this right now. I'm from the UK originally. I've been living in the Bay Area now for about 8 years, more or less, but I've managed to retain my British accent, which I'm very proud of. So this is normally the first thing people notice when they meet me. And very often the first thing that people will want to tell me is that they have some family connection to the UK. And you probably would do this as well if we meet later on. Let me know that you have maybe grandparents from England or maybe a great-grandparent that came from Scotland. And this is a very natural way of establishing a connection with people. I do the same thing. I have grandparents from Ireland and from Poland. And so if I meet people from those countries, I like to kind of compare notes with them, like see if we have any overlap in our family history. This is because family is very important to us. Whether we're aware of the influence or not, our family history has a real influence on who we are. Where we come from informs who we are. And so I like to extend this metaphor beyond our family tree to the entire universe. So the universe as well can be thought of as having a family history, a kind of a family tree. There are generations of stars that are born and die, and they all influence everything that comes after them, including us. And I mean this in a very real way, in a very direct way. All the atoms in my body, all the atoms in your bodies, all the atoms in the Earth were forged in the heart of dying stars. So we really are made from the ashes of the previous generations of the universe. Where the universe comes from impacts who we are. And where the universe is going in the future is going to impact where we're going. And this is one of the reasons why I study cosmology. Cosmology is the study of the history of the universe. And I think there's something that's really important to our identity as people, to understand something about the history of the universe as a whole, and also our place in that universe. So when we want to get an idea about the origin of our species, origin of Homo sapiens, we go to archaeology, which looks back maybe tens or hundreds of thousands of years. And in cosmology, we're looking back to the history of the universe, and the universe is 13.8 billion years old. So you can think of cosmology as being a real extreme form of archaeology. But that doesn't mean that it's something that's an abstract science. It doesn't mean that it's, it's just hand-waving. It's something that we really do have a connection to. In archaeology, when we see cave paintings like these made by our ancestors thousands of years ago, we have a real visceral reaction to something like this. We imagine what it might have been like to put our hands up on that cave wall and make an imprint. And so we start to imagine what the life was like for the people who made those cave paintings. And in a similar way, when we see a galaxy that's millions of years old, or maybe even billions of years old, we make that same connection to our own galaxy, to our Milky Way. And we might imagine, well, perhaps this is an adolescent version of our own galaxy, or maybe it's a completely different branch of the family tree from our own galaxy, but we still have a connection to what we see out there. And the reason that we can see this, the reason that we can see galaxies from millions or billions of years ago, is because light travels very fast through the universe. It's the fastest thing there is. But the size of the universe is unimaginably vast. The distances that light has to travel to reach us are huge. I mean, even light from the sun, which is our closest star, it takes 8 minutes to reach us. So something crazy can be going on with the sun. It can wink out like this. And then it'll take 8 minutes for us to even notice that's happening. But if we can catch a glimpse of light from very distant galaxies, then that light will have traveled through the universe for billions upon billions of years to reach us. And so this allows us to take a glimpse back in time to see what the universe was like when it was very young. And this is kind of like finding like a fossilized tooth or a bone shard or something like that in archaeology. You might only have a fragment of information, a little shard of information, but that can still tell us an enormous amount about what the environment was like back then. So we see galaxies because they emit light. We use telescopes, which look at the sky through various different wavelengths of light. And so we see the stars in the galaxies. We also see the dust and the gas in that galaxies. We see these with different types of telescopes because they emit different wavelengths of light. But we know, we found out in the last 40 years or so, that everything we've ever seen through our telescopes only makes up 20% of the matter in the universe. The other 80% is made up of what we call dark matter. And this is something that's pretty exciting for scientists. So dark matter is surprisingly, I guess, well-named in astronomy. We're often assigned things somewhat obscure names like cluster Abel 1689. It's not obvious to people what this means, but dark matter's got a very sensible name, a very logical name. It's dark, which because it doesn't glow, it doesn't interact with light, it is literally dark. But that doesn't mean that it's intangible. It's matter, so that means that it has mass, it has heft. And because of that, we see the influence of dark matter through its gravity. If something has mass and it has gravity, and we see the effect of the gravitational pull of dark matter wherever we look in the universe, not just in galaxies. In fact, if we sort of take a step back and sort of take the wider picture of the universe, we might want to do something like taking a census of the universe, maybe making a survey of where all the galaxies are. I mean, when we look at our data from a survey like this, we see that the galaxies aren't distributed around randomly, you know, they're not evenly distributed throughout space. There's a definite pattern to where the galaxies are. It kind of looks like a bit of a web. We call this the cosmic web. The pattern of galaxies is not sort of smoothly distributed, it's all clustered together. And this is simply because of the force of gravity. It's a force of the gravitational pull of the galaxies themselves, and also of the dark matter. So we can run computer simulations of a universe that contains regular matter and dark matter, and we're able to reproduce this kind of pattern, this kind of cosmic web, pretty well. So we don't know what dark matter is. That's the big caveat to all this. We've never sort of been able to catch a bit of dark matter and, you know, look at it and try to measure it itself. But we've got a really good idea about what dark matter does, and we knew this because of its gravitational pull. So we think that we've got a fairly good idea of what the universe is made of. We think we understand something about what's in the universe, but of course that's only one part of the puzzle. If we want to learn something about and understand something about the history of the universe, we need to include the dimension of time, and we need to see how the universe is changing over time. In these figures here, the vertical axis is the distance of the galaxies away from us. So as you look up the wedge, you're basically looking back in time. And if you look at the very top of the wedge there, we're looking back in time about 2.5 billion years. And you'll notice there that the galaxies are not sort of located in this same web-like structure. And they're much more evenly distributed. They sort of look more randomly distributed. And this is simply because nothing stays static over time. The universe certainly doesn't stay static over time. It takes time for gravity to pull everything together in these structures. So the universe is not a static place. Of course, the generations of stars are being born and die. Galaxies are colliding and merging all the time. But underneath that, space itself is expanding underneath us. You can kind of think of this as species on Earth evolving quite happily, completely oblivious to the movement of the tectonic plates underneath us. It's not something that we can feel. But space itself is expanding. And about 15 years ago, we discovered that not only is space expanding, but that expansion is accelerating. The expansion of space is speeding up. And this is really exciting for scientists, because we don't have a good explanation about why this might be happening. We call this dark energy. Whatever's driving this accelerated expansion of the universe, we call it dark energy. And here, it's called dark, mostly because we're in the dark about it. We don't have a good explanation for it, but we do love a good mystery to get our teeth into as scientists. So it's one of the, probably the, I think personally, because this is something I work on, I think it's probably the most important mystery in science today, the most important thing that we need to understand in science today, because without it, we're simply not going to be able to understand the history of the universe. We're not going to be able to get a coherent picture of the history of the universe without understanding what dark energy is and what it's doing. So the tools that we use to gather together all these diverse bits of information are telescopes. And probably the most famous telescope of all is the Hubble Space Telescope. I think it's everybody's favorite telescope, even astronomers. We get fantastic astronomical scientific data from the Hubble Telescope, as well as beautiful images of the cosmos and really spectacular pictures. So Hubble is a telescope which is in space. It's in orbit around the Earth. And this means that it has a real advantage because it doesn't have to worry about day or night. It doesn't have to worry about whether it's cloudy or whether it's raining. It can stare at the same tiny patch of sky for days or even weeks, which means that it's the ideal tool for catching a glimpse of light from these very distant galaxies and allowing us to catch a glimpse back in time to when the universe was in its adolescence or even in its childhood. But if we wanted to take a census of the universe and try to make a survey of space, then Hubble's just not the right tool for the job. It'd be kind of like trying to light up a room with a laser pointer, maybe. It's just not going to work. So I wanted to tell you about a revolutionary new telescope that I work on that's going to really allow us to make a comprehensive survey of the universe. So whereas Hubble is kind of a precision instrument, kind of like a scalpel, you can think of this telescope as being a cosmic excavator. It's going to unearth information about tens of billions of galaxies. It'll be taking this survey for about 10 years. And at the end of that 10 years, this telescope will have seen more of the universe than all previous telescopes put together. It's going to be fantastic. It's called the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope. And as you can imagine, for something that's going to be taking such a big survey of the universe, this is not your average back garden telescope. You're not going to be using this to go stargazing in your backyard. This isn't probably going to fit in your backyard. It's a huge telescope. It's as big as a house. The main mirror alone is about 8.5 meters in diameter, which is, you know, a significant proportion of the size of this stage. It's a very big instrument. And as was mentioned in the introduction, I work at the SLAC National Accelerator Laboratory. And up there, we're responsible for delivering the camera for the telescope. And fittingly for something that's going to give us the big picture and the universe, this is going to be the biggest digital camera the world's ever seen. This is also enormous. It's about the size of a car. And the focal plane alone is this kind of size. It's about like 50 or 60 centimeters across. And it contains more than 3 billion pixels. That's more than 500 times as many pixels as you get in your average iPhone. So this is, we're really pushing the limits of camera technology by developing this camera. And who knows, maybe sometime in the future, some of the delicate instrumentation we're developing for this camera will find its way into your iPhone. I certainly hope so. So there are hundreds of scientists and engineers working on this project in the US and all around the world. And we're busy at the moment preparing for the flood of data we're going to get from this telescope, because it's going to be coming pretty soon. And this is what's really exciting about this project, is that we're going to start construction in just a few weeks from now. The Large Synoptic Survey Telescope is going to be built on a mountaintop in Chile, where the air is clear and the weather's very predictable. So we start construction in a few weeks, and then around 8 or 9 years after that, we're going to start what is effectively the most extreme archaeological dig the world's ever seen. LSST is going to give us the first really comprehensive survey of the universe, and it's going to allow us to understand the history of the universe in a way we've never been able to do before, and to understand our place in that history. So 15 years ago, when I was in college, it was only 15 years ago, we didn't know about dark energy. I never learned about this in college. This wasn't something that we knew existed. And you can imagine 15 years from now, what other surprises the universe might have to throw at us. So I think, for me, this is a tremendously exciting time to be a cosmologist, to be on the brink of all this data, all this information, all this potential discovery. And I really think it's an exciting time to be a human being. So I really hope that you will all be excited and inspired by what we discover. Thank you.